Many thanks, firstly, for your attendance during lunchtime. I accepted this time, you know, for diet reason. Even if, you know, I feel good, you don't know it, but I just come back from holidays, and you don't know it, but Google knows exactly where I was. Of course, my bank account knows my expense. Instagram identified the place I loved, and TripAdvisor, the hotel and the restaurant I booked. So you understand that we will speak about data, about e-privacy, about what we are calling GDPR, General Data Protection Regulation. Its impact on our business, what you need to know, and why you should not be afraid of it. And to start this session, I would like to show you a two-minute video. This is an extract, or I would say a key moment, from Mark Zuckerberg's testimony in front of the United States Congress. Please pay attention to the first question that the senator will ask to Mark Zuckerberg.
Mr. Zuckerberg, would you be comfortable sharing with us the name of the hotel you stayed in last night?
No.
If you've messaged anybody this week, would you share with us the names of the people you've messaged?
Senator, no, I would probably not choose to do that publicly here.
I think that might be what this is all about. Your right to privacy, the limits of your right to privacy, and how much you give away in modern America in the name of, quote, connecting people around the world. Question basically of what information Facebook's collecting, who they're sending it to, and whether they ever asked me in advance my permission to do that. Is that a fair thing for a user of Facebook to expect?
Yes, Senator. I think everyone should have control over how their information is used. And as we've talked about in some of the other questions, I think that that is laid out in some of the documents. But more importantly, you want to give people control in the product itself. So the most important way that this happens across our services is that every day people come to our services to choose to share photos or send messages. And every single time they choose to share something, they have a control right there about who they want to share it with.
So if you watch all the videos about this testimony, you will see that, of course, Mark Zuckerberg proved how Facebook is useful. Useful for you, for people, useful for companies, useful for institutions or NGO, of course. But, you know, it was for him a tricky exercise, and it was difficult for him. And Zuckerberg recognized his mistake in the past. And there is this long silence of 6 seconds after the senator's question about the hotel. But finally, the day after, as you can see, the newspaper headlines shows that finally Zuckerberg survived to this testimony, to the exercise. And as you saw in the video, he even took after the advantage by asking a question to the senator. So since the 25th of May, we just have one question. Am I GDPR compliant? Are you GDPR ready? Some of you will certainly say, well, my company is based in Australia or in the United States or in Argentina. I don't have to be GDPR compliant. I'm not concerned by this. But no, wherever you are, if you use European citizen data, you have to comply with GDPR. Just one example, 2 or 3 weeks ago, US newspapers decided to cut the access to their content to Europe. Why? Because they just panicked. They didn't anticipate the fact that they have to be GDPR compliant. But I think it's not a good reaction. They shouldn't panic like this. And this session exists to explain and to prove that GDPR is not really a nightmare. We don't have to be afraid of it. So as you can see, all the world is concerned, and you don't have to panic, and you have to be zen with GDPR because you have several points to respect. Since the 25th of May, we haven't seen any earthquake. And to prove it, I'm very pleased to welcome Florence Gollier from Verken and Gollier Law Firm. Verken and Gollier Law Firm works at the international level on copyright and on GDPR. She refuses a lot of clients today because every day companies call for GDPR to be GDPR compliant, and there is this wind of panic. And I'm very pleased to welcome Thomas. Thomas contacted me 1 year ago about GDPR, and we work together on it. So I would like Thomas, to tell you your story today, the story of your company and GDPR. When when did you start to work firstly on GDPR, and how did you hear about it?
Is it okay? I just raised myself for a short introduction, and then I will be back answering this question. But let's just face it, we worked for this for 1 year and a half. I believe we are GDPR compliant, and we haven't had visitors from the data authorities yet. But I think we're there. Just short, my name is Thomas Weilemann, CEO of Infomedia. We are in the Nordic region of Europe, so we have offices now in Stockholm, Oslo, Copenhagen. We just bought Opine Technology, so we also do web crawling and selling of web content for the MMOs and PR agencies, so we have now an international approach to the market. We have an IT set up in Russia, St. Petersburg, which is of interest as well when you talk about GDPR. And then we have a team of 35, 40 people in Chennai, organized by Nine Stars, supporting some of our processing activities. Very short view into this. I didn't know we were supposed to be in black. So I'm not compliant regarding clothing. Another view could be I'm maybe the most optimistic when it comes to compliant, black and the more light colors. Or maybe I'm the one that does not really understand what this is about, so I'm just an optimistic guy, you know, thinking we are compliant. Few points for the introduction. That was really important when we started this. First of all, I don't think I'm responsible for a company where the core business is handling of personal data. That's a very important point. I think I'm responsible for a company. I'm in the media monitoring, media analysis market. I think I'm responsible for a company where we mainly handle public information, you know, coming from all the medias. It's a really important point. But on the other hand, it raises some questions, because what actually happens when you transform your company up north, east, like we're doing in Infomedia, going from the print clippings to the media analysis, media intelligence, and maybe even prediction part of the business. What does that raise? Does that raise questions? I think that could be a good discussion to have as well. What does that really mean? It definitely, when you go for media analysis and media intelligence and you deliver an integrated portfolio or integrated platform, it opens up for the whole social media arena. That makes the lines a bit blurry, but also when you use machine learning and artificial intelligence on top of public available information, what actually happens? I suddenly create a new profile of the prime minister in the Danish market, for instance, by public available information. We do some search, we do some intelligence on top, and suddenly we have a new profile. What does that actually mean? I think that's of great interest as well. We welcome basically the GDPR initiative. I just see it as a component into our business model, where we definitely need to strengthen business processes around this journey in terms of making transparency, trust, et cetera, towards the media, because in reality, media monitoring, media analysis is kind of a black box. We make lots of media agreements, lots of pricing agreements, and the question could be, can the media actually trust us in how we manage and control all this and pay back? So the need for transparency and trust definitely is there. And then the customer side as well. We do deals, lots of different deals, media monitoring, media analysis, where we guarantee coverage of these and those medias, but can they actually trust us that we do like what is in the contract? So I think we have to work on the trust and transparency anyway. So I just see GDPR as one component into this. I have some slides just to help you. It all started with data mapping. Very, very detailed data map. That's where it all starts. You know, the key data, employees, customers, medias, whatever. And a list of questions over here. That goes into the archive in Infomedia now. And it will be updated ongoing. But that was basically the platform for how we work with GDPR. We had a lawyer firm to help us in completing this and making a full coverage. And then we organized our project like this. I will come back on those issues. But I think external lawyer, internal lawyer in the company, and also good networking with people in the industry, very much thank you to Kantar Media and Christophe for helping on this, and Florence. So we met several times. But these are the key areas. And just for your awareness, I did make some slides. I will not walk them through because we rather want an interactive session. But for each of these areas, you know, what was the basic legal principles? We will cover that. But also, what was the approach to employee and data information that will be distributed for the customer side as well? What was the key point? I think, Florence, it's really important for this session to come around what the legitimate interest. And also what is called consent. Really two important criteria for GDPR. We will be back on this. IT investments, IT focus areas, you will have the material, we will cover that. How we wrapped it up in documentation and handbooks. The business case, we will cover that, but I just want to make you aware that I did some slides where it's all summarized. And the biggest challenges.
Yeah.
It ended up like this. We think we are GDPR compliant. This is my DPO, data process officer. Cool guy. He helped us through the process. He's also the quality manager and the process manager. And Infomedia, I can come back on this. I think we maybe will continue further doing going for an ISO 9000 certification in the end to cover what I said initially, that is about making transparency and trust for media, customers, all the stakeholders around us.
Thanks, Thomas. You answered my first questions.
Yes, 1 year and a half.
Okay, so you appointed a DPO. I would like to know, Florence, is it an obligation to appoint a DPO?
Well, it's not always an obligation. The GDPR says that you have to appoint a DPO when your core activities entails processing operations on a large scale of data. The problem is,
what is a
large scale? And nobody knows today. We don't know if it's 10,000 data, 100,000, 1 billion. We don't know. But I would say, to make it simple, that when you process a lot of data, like in your activities, you have to appoint a DPO. It's a data protection officer.
And what is the role, so, of a data protection officer?
The data protection officer is someone who will be in charge of the GDPR compliance in the company or if in a group of companies. It means that he must devise and control what is done with data in the company or the group. He has to inform and to advise the employees, but also the management. He has to monitor what is done and to say when it's not compliant and to write it down, to document it. And he has also to cooperate with the data protection authority. It can be an employee, but it can be also an external co-contractor. And he has to have some professional skills in data protection laws, but also in IT, because there are also IT questions with GDPR. It can be one DPO for a group of companies, but each company has to have access really to the DPO when it is a shared DPO. It must not be theoretical.
Thomas, when you appointed this team, was it a full-time job? Is it time-consuming to work on GDPR?
I think that depends of the size of the company. It was having this GDPO role was not a full-time role in Infomedia. Although it took us 1 year and a half, but it was not full-time. I think we succeeded with, well, of course, it's business handling data, personal data, but we tried to build and position the project in a little bit different way. So we really tried to integrate this initiative into what we have to do anyway, in terms of investing in technology, bringing costs down, having more efficient processes, just be a professional company. So we kind of increased his role. So he was supporting quality management initiatives, technology investments, profitability initiatives, and on that note, it became a full-time role. Mm. It also became a better platform for communication of this, because some people, you know, well, personal data, does that impact me, but they all understand that we need to be competitive, we need to be efficient, we need to be professional.
What did your team, your GDPR team, did first? I mean,
that was actually this a bit boring.
What is the first step?
That was definitely the data mapping.
Data mapping.
That was the data mapping.
So where are your data? External data? Yes. Internal data?
Yes, and it took several months actually. To identify everything, but that was a big one, also because mapping all the data, being surprised in some areas. So, are we really having those data? Are we using them at all? So, and there is the question also: should we get rid of some? Should we get rid of some data? But it was also a risk analysis based on the data mapping. You know, where do we see the risk? And that is, of course, pointing to the most important initiatives. And especially also the most important technology and IT investments we needed to do.
Florence, what is the best way to apply the GDPR? Are there several ways to be GDPR compliant?
Yes, of course, there are many ways to be compliant, and it depends on the type and on the size of the business. But some key points are necessary in the compliance process, and these key steps will have to be done in every company. For example, in any case, you will have to appoint a pilot, even if it's not a DPO, but you need a pilot. You need also to do this data mapping. It's the first step to identify all personal data processing. You also need to conduct a GDPR compliance audit of each processing. You will have to check all these key points. You will have to set up plan actions with priorities and a timeline. You will always have also to draft and to communicate privacy policies. You will often have to modify and to sign new contracts with clients and with suppliers. And last example, you will always have to set up some procedures in your company to be able to answer to people's requests when they want to exercise their rights, their GDPR rights, and also to be ready to notify a data breach to the data protection authorities, and sometimes also to people. So you have to be ready, and you must be prepared to do that. You can't do that if you have no procedures. Mm.
Thomas, did you make a difference between suppliers and clients, suppliers who send you data and clients who receive data from you?
Yes, yes, we did. I think, first of all, if we start with the client side, just going
you
back
start with the client side.
Yeah, but we started with the client
we
side.
We made the opposite at Kantar Media.
Yeah, but you can maybe explain.
Yeah.
I think we started with the client side. And the key, I think the key point here was that we do not see us, you know, handling, processing personal data. That's not the core business. And another key point towards the clients was the legitimate
interest
of having client data. And what that means, you can explain it even better than me. I'm not a lawyer, but it means that we cannot allow. For instance, if you just go for what is called consent, which is a very important element as well, we cannot allow that client can call us and, for instance, have it with a demand of erasuring all data going back. We have to have a historical data also going back. We might lose a client, but we might want to regain the client the year after. There can be questions relating to invoicing and. So that was really a key point.
Mm.
For the data, for the suppliers, I think we have a couple of issues. One is that we, in the social media arena, we do now strong partnership with Talkwalker, Brainwatch, and Hootsuite, and that definitely goes into a data process agreement.
Mm.
And some of them, they are quite big companies. They have their headquarters in US, and so it takes a little bit of time to get. To get this in place. And there's, of course, the discussion, you know, who owns which kind of data when it comes to social media.
Yeah.
That's a key point as well.
Mm. See, Florence, people think that a public data like social media, like Twitter, or like Facebook, is not under GDPR. Is it true?
No, it isn't true. personal data means any information related to a person, directly or indirectly. And the fact that the data are public and are on social media and free, accessible, available, will not change that. They are personal data, they are protected. It's not exactly the same protection, but you will have to comply with some of these key points and obligations, even if it's public.
Mm. So we are talking about legitimate interest, mm-hmm. and we think that to avoid GDPR application, we can use this legitimate interest. What is the legitimate interest?
This is a very good question. Thank you, Christophe, to ask it. No, you cannot avoid all GDPR obligations just with legitimate interest. But we speak a lot about this legitimate interest concept because it can be used to avoid consent of people to process their data.
So, for example, I'm working in a marketing team. I send emails for prospects, and I can use this legitimate interest?
In some cases, we will see that later, but in some cases you can avoid consent, but you cannot avoid all these obligations because what is legitimate interest? It's one of the legal basis to process data because in the GDPR principles, you have one of the principle, it's here, this is lawfulness and legal basis. It's one of the principle, and it means that your processing of data must be lawful, and you have six legal bases in the GDPR. The most famous one is consent, but you have five other legal bases. You have, for example, the contract, because you can use data to perform a contract. You can have also legal obligations to process data. And you have these six legal bases, which is legitimate interest. It means that when you have a legitimate interest to process data, you can process data without consent. But first of all, it does not mean that you will not have to comply with all other principles. You will have to comply with transparency principle. You will have to inform people. You will have to comply with their rights so they can object, for example, to the processing. So it's not a reason to avoid all obligations. And it's not an easy basis to use because you have to demonstrate that you cannot use another legal basis. You have to demonstrate that you have made a balance between your interests and the interests of the people. It must be a processing that the, people can expect, reasonably expect, not something very different. So it's not easy to use, but it's a legal basis that a lot of companies want to choose because you can avoid consent with that legal basis.
It's a bit technical this, but it's really a key into this, and just spending one day with Florence on this and really understanding it last December, we saved a lot of money on this, because the key is here that we in some areas are allowed to inform, and if the customer or the partner is not having any reaction on it, you know, we can proceed rather than we cannot proceed, because we have to have an acceptance. It's a big difference.
And for example,
so if you have a technical issue on this, I would just, because it is a bit technical, I would recommend go and talk to Florent, because it saves you a lot of money on to have this evaluation on especially this subject.
Thomas, you work with Russia, you work with India. Was it difficult to explain to them what is GDPR? They understood it?
No, because the Russian part is of course the most difficult one when you look at it firsthand side, because of all the stuff going on at Putin level. But in reality, we were a bit smart when we chose Russia. You could ask the question, why go for Russia for IT development? But the prices are just going up in Ukraine and Poland, whatever, and they have really good people in Russia. And it's a nice place to go. And we were smart. We selected a company that was established already working for actually some insurance and also healthcare companies. So they had their procedures in place regarding stuff like this, GDPR. So that was not a big thing. Regarding India and Chennai and Nine Stars, that's not really an issue, because they basically process and clip the PDF. Material we have, and it does not go for personal data.
In the last FIBEP newsletter, you wrote that GDPR was like an opportunity for Infomedia, and on the same time, some consider GDPR like an obligation. With you have to appoint a DPO, you have to spend money. Where is the added value?
No, but you know the expression, we have that in Denmark, when you look at the glass, is it half empty or is it half full? So it's just an approach to stuff. I mean, you can go crying every day about issues and problems, but you can also say, well, we're not going just to have issues to disappear. So it goes back to my introduction, we just see it as a component into building a professional business model anyhow, where there's a need in our industry to have a bit more transparency and trust also on what we're doing. It's not only the media's having an issue, you know, how can media's and customers trust what you're actually doing up against contracts? No one can really see it. So I believe in some systematic approach to this, and I believe if I'm the first one communicating I'm in place, I go for certification, whatever, I might have a competitive advantage on this.
So that's
the view to it.
So for you, this is a new professional step?
It is. We were working on part of it anyway, but we also got some surprises. On the whole HR side, the employee side, well, we were, to be honest, a bit unprofessional. A lot of data were spread around in the organization for handled by different managers. And well, when you look at it from our, well, it's not a good way of handling employee data. So we implemented a new simple HR system, and in the end, it's more easy to use, and we spend more less time on handling HR issues, and we are much sharper now in how we onboard new people because we know how to what to ask them about when they join us and not afterwards, and we also are much sharper on offboarding people. You know, it's an industry of change. So we know much better now how to onboard, how to offboard.
So on a scale of 10 level, where are you exactly today?
11? No. I was just surprised because is that a French scale up to 11 or?
No.
No, it's 1 to 11. No, I think we are seven, eight. It would be too much bragging if I said 11. 7, 8, but I feel comfortable in what we're doing.
Mm-hmm. Florence, the last 2 months, I received on my email box a lot of emails and hundreds of email links saying be GDPR compliant, be GDPR compliant. A lot of consulting firms played on fear and anxiety. Do we have to panic? Do we have to panic like the US newspaper in the United States?
No, this regulation is indeed subject to a huge fear-based marketing, and there are also a lot of fake news or wrong advices also, because I don't know why, but there are a lot of so-called experts who discovered the regulation a few months ago and thought that it would be a good occasion to make money with it. So, for example, in our activity, it's really an issue for lawyers because when you know the regulation, we have clients and potential clients who are scared, who are confused because they don't know what they have to do. So my advice is no, don't panic, keep calm. It's not so big, it's not so impossible to do. And to be honest, nobody is really compliant, except Infomedia, of course. and there is a lot of questions that are open, and you just have to begin and to work, of course, on it, but you don't have to be compliant today. Yeah, it's not possible. And you just have to try to implement an action plan with some priorities, I would say before the end of the year, for some subjects which are more important.
Mm. Thomas?
No, as I said before, I don't think you should be crying about this, but of course it's a serious thing. We haven't seen the consequences of not being compliant. So, what will be the first or the second examples of consequences that will maybe be an eye opener? We don't know yet. Mm. From a business point of view, I'm a bit more concerned on, you started with your Zuckerberg movie, I'm a bit more concerned of the restrictions we see on API access to Instagram and Facebook, because we build a lot of business initiatives around that. I think that's a big business concern. I'm really keen on also seeing how that develops, or if they loosen a bit, or we have to to find new ways around that. That is a consequence you can feel immediately as well. You maybe already have contracts with clients where you promised to deliver this and that. Now you can't do it. We already have discussions like that with some Nordic clients. I mean, so it's a bigger thing than not just being compliant yourself. It's also something going on out there.
Mm. Florence, from a legal point of view, we can understand GDPR compliancy, of course, but it appears that GDPR is firstly to protect B2C environment, and we all work in a B2B environment.
Yes, in theory, GDPR is applies to B2C and B2B environments. But of course, the need for privacy is not the same in a B2B environment and in a B2C environment. In my opinion, the purpose of the GDPR is really to protect consumers more than professionals. And one should apply the GDPR rules with more flexibility in B2B relationships than in the B2C ones. Especially in the marketing matters.
Mm.
For example, in France, the Data Protection Authority, which is called the CNIL, has a flexible interpretation of e-privacy rules for marketing communications in the B2B relationships. And it considers that you don't need consent for marketing emails between professionals. I know it's not the same in other countries, but I think that it's a good way of thinking and to apply different rules in B2C and B2B environments.
Mm. So it's a revolution, but it will take time. We
have a business-to-business consumer element in our business because we have a media archive. And we sell the media archive for to the Ministry of Education, and that means that schools, universities, they can access the media archive.
Mm.
And that was basically a surprise. We never used the data, but we were actually sitting on personal data for children and up. So we could do search profiles on consumers.
Mm.
We never used it, but that is an element, you know, suddenly showing up, and it could be misused.
Mm.
That you could, so it was nice to identify, and we handle it.
Mm. Florence, a last question before Q&A session. What about the fact that GDPR seems to be against improvement and development? Do you think that we will leave finally the future to Asia or America?
I don't think so. I think that the answer to your question will depend on the way we choose to apply the rules. In my opinion, one must not oppose GDPR and business improvement and development. We must not forget that before everything, the GDPR wants to protect us, to protect privacy, to protect our private lives. It is to ensure the efficiency of fundamental rights. So it's very essential. And if we oppose business and GDPR, it means that we are opposing business to human rights. So in my opinion, there is a way to manage GDPR and business without killing improvement, development, and innovation. Because GDPR is setting key principles, but there are many ways to interpret the rules and to apply them. There is a margin of flexibility to adapt the rules to each sector, to each industry. And for example, in France, the CNIL, the Data Protection Authority, is working with each industry to adapt the rules to the sector, and it's for me it's really the key to find a way, which is a good way between business and GDPR compliance, and Lastly, I would also say that business in Europe in the digital era cannot develop without trust of EU citizens, because the EU citizens now are really sensitive about the subject, and people will be afraid to give access to their data if they don't trust companies. So I would say that by applying GDPR, you will protect individuals and you will protect your own interests. I hope so.
Thank you very much. Thank you both for your expertise. Is there any question? Yeah. So.
Hi, I'm Juan from Búho, Colombia. Of course, as non-Europeans, probably the first we heard about the GDPR was the 26th of May this
25.
Year.
25. 25th. Yes.
Yeah, 26th. So we were kind of the mixed experience of the panic and the relaxation. But really, my question is, I've heard you talking about the protection of data of clients, customers, partners, and so on. And we feel comfortable that our local legislations has taken us to a reasonable level of protection. But I'm wondering about the database we use to reach insights in our business, like the statements of journalists, columnists, the Twitter feeds of individuals. That kind of data is, first, the GDPR is concerned about how we use that data. If we have a database of tweets talking about a brand, how do we deal with that? And secondly, what's the trend? What's the future? What's the 5 year of the European and probably American legislation on that matter?
Well, three questions for you.
I'm sorry.
This is the big question in your activities, and we worked a lot together. We are not totally sure of the answers. We have tried to work on different possibilities. The first one is to try to use an exemption in the GDPR, which is an exemption for journalism processing, journalistic processing. The problem is that this exemption is at the beginning has been made for publishers, so websites and paper magazines, etc. So we are not sure that this exemption could be applied to media monitoring activities. It could be because the case law of the European Court of Justice has a large interpretation of this exemption, but in each country we have not the same interpretation, and the GDPR did not change that. It's really an issue because you have to check in all country, in all European country laws, how they have implemented this exemption. So it's a possibility, but we are not sure that it will be the best ones. The other one is legitimate interests, so that you can use this data without consent. But it means that you will have to inform. You will have to inform, and we don't know how to do that. We can try to use another exemption and to say that it's impossible to inform people about the processing. But for example, in France, we have a case law which was very, very strict about that. And the CNIL, the Data Protection Authority in France, found that we had to ask to media social media companies there that they ask to they inform people about our processing. So I don't know, but it's really a big question, and I launch a call. Everyone who is working on this question, call me. I want to discuss about it.
But I think we
have to work together and to propose something, and not to wait that the data protection authorities.
We have to be proactive, in fact. Mm-hmm. And at Kantar Media, we will approach the authority to take security. And I don't know if the exception will be applied in France and outside in all Kantar Media countries. But we will see, we will do our best. So this is a wide space, and we have to make our best to protect our activity. Perhaps a last question.
Lobbying.
A last question. No? We have no time, so.
We'll look for you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.